I'm going home with Jesus in the twinkling of an eye. I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, or I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. I'm going home with Jesus in the twinkling of an eye. I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, or I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. I'm listening for the trumpet to sound most any time, and a crown of life that's waiting, thank God, will soon be mine. I got my invitation through a place called Calvary. By the precious blood of Jesus, this trip's been paid for me. I'm going home with Jesus in the twinkling of an eye. I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, or I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. The captain of the vessel is calling, get on board. And the destination's heaven, safe on that crystal shore, where we'll meet again the Savior and our loved ones who have gone. There to live for all eternity. Oh yes, we're going home. I'm going home with Jesus in the twinkling of an eye. I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, or I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. I'm going home with Jesus in the twinkling of an eye. I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, or I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away.
Say praise the Lord right big. A little better. That's better. How many is going to heaven? How many want to go? Well, let me let you in on a little clue. Wanting to is not going to make it. You're going to have to put something in it. Amen. Nobody is going to sneak in. No one's going to accidentally go to heaven. No one's going to find themselves in heaven unless they intentionally here on earth walked with God and went with him and did the things that God wanted. And we have the opportunity, man, every one of us, if we want to go to heaven, we can go if we like. How would you like to go? Really, really? I'm talking about putting the shoe soles on the bottom of the feet, amen, and find a church that preaches the truth and stay there. I'm going to give you a little bit of a rundown on what we're doing today. It's a little bit of a cool day, a little bit of a rainy day. And we may have to do a little bit different than we had planned. But we'll get through the day. I'll guarantee it. God's still in charge. So let's remember, we came to worship. We came to just have a good time in the Lord, not to anybody to be whatever, but we've come, amen, that we can just look up to God and offer ourselves to him and say, we're going home. We're going home. Amen. How about it? Are we going home? Let's all stand, and we're going to, as I said, I was going to give everybody kind of a little bit of a rundown on what we're going to do today. We're going to have the Heirline. They're going to be singing about an hour. We're going to be hearing some preaching, some of the best I'll guarantee that you'll hear. This man is one of the best preachers I've ever had an encounter down through the years. And we've been friends and been together, and we've been just, I guess you'd have to say, buddy, buddy. He's one of my best friends. And I really appreciate him. I appreciate him taking the time being here. But you're going to get the enjoyment of sitting and listening to him. So remember, we didn't come just to do what we wanted to do, but we came, amen, that we might lift up God, lift up our Savior, and do the thing, amen, that he had for us to do. But let's pray and ask God's blessing, and then we'll get the Heirlines on the floor. This rain might change your plans a little bit, but just go with the flow. God's gone, as I said, was in charge, and let you and I just go with it. Amen. If God allows it to rain, there must be a reason for it. Don't look and say, "Well, how come God didn't bless the homecoming?" But we, amen, are realizing that God still has his ways. So come on, let's pray together, and we're going to go back, and we got a meal after the church is over. We'll do what we need to do, but one thing we are going to do is feed on the gospel and feed on the food. So we'll do that together. Let's all pray and ask God's blessing, and we'll get the Heirlines on the floor. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, you know the need that we have, and you're able that you can touch each life and each mind. And would you bless now the words that are going to be spoken, the songs that are going to be sung, and bless hearts to enjoy. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. The Heirlines are going without break. We aren't going to take that break like we usually do. But anyway, sit back. Stand up, do whatever, amen, you feel like doing. If you want to worship, you're the one that has to do it. So come on, let's have a good time in the Lord. This is homecoming. We've been looking forward to it, and it's here today. Might be, as I said, it might be a little bit rainy, but I believe God will take care of things, and everything will be okay, and we'll have a good time, and we'll enjoy one another's company, and just come on and enjoy. God bless you.
To walk the narrow way, I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday. Amen. There's a golden street to walk upon. Hell, I'm gonna ring. There's a brand new angel in the choir. I'm gonna hear her sing. There'll be a lot of friends waiting when I walk through the gate. I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday. Amen. If you got more to go to heaven for today, let's give the Lord a hand this morning. Amen. Let's worship him today. Thank you, Lord. Now I've been on some valleys and I've found the highest hill. Friend, I've known the joys of living in the center of God's will. I've watched the angels come and take my loved ones home to stay. I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday. There's a golden street to walk upon, there I'm going to be. There's a brand new angel in the choir, I'm going to hear her sing. There'll be a lot of friends waiting when I walk through the gate. I've got more to go to heaven for, I But if they're in a heaven, their day is brighter, and we're gonna live where there's no night.
Precious Jesus, light my pathway until I reach.
Never seen me with a guitar up here before, have you? How many of you know that when you need help, it's always on the way, and he'll always be there for you no matter what in any situation? You can call on him when you can't call on nobody else, and he'll be right there. So I'm happy, you know, to sing this song today because it's true. Just listen to the words of it. Let it minister to you like it does to me, and I hope you enjoy it. A woman is Bible days, her last meal almost gone. But God sent Elijah to make his word known. He said, woman, don't you worry, for God sent me today. And before you even asked him, help was on
hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. A brighter day is coming for those who believe and pray. Well, help won't help tomorrow if you give up today. Just hold on a little longer, 'cause help is on. You think no one is listening. You think no one's around. Just remember what his word says. Trust him and obey. Keep your eyes toward the heavens, 'cause help is on the way. Just hold on a little longer.
Yes, amen.
Help is on the way. A brighter day is coming for those who believe and pray. Well, help won't help tomorrow if you give up today. Just hold on a little longer, 'cause help is on the way. Hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. A brighter day is coming for those who believe and pray. Well, help won't help tomorrow if you give up today. Just hold on a little. Help is on the way.
We need more to go to heaven for. We already did that. More to go to heaven.
Okay. Amen. I'm thankful today that God's still saving me, still taking care of me this morning. I tell you what. We was driving here the other night, and I'm driving down the road, and Austin and I were just sitting there talking, and you know they put those little barrier cones in the weirdest places sometimes. I mean, all of a sudden it just showed up in my lane, and I happened to look up, and I went over, and Austin's over, he's looking at his phone and stuff, and he goes, ooh, real fast like that. I said, Lord took care of us right there. I tell you what, I'm thankful that he's always got his hands on me, amen. I tell you, I want Austin to come sing his song because it says, if that wasn't God, y'all sing it with us.
My Savior was raised from a dark, lonely grave. Death could not force him to stay. Now there were unbelievers who said, this deceiver, the disciples have stole him away. The devil has tried to turn us aside and tell us that it just isn't true. But if you had ears, Satan, that you could hear, here's what we'd have to say to you.
If that wasn't God, tell me who was at a coming out of that tomb. And who were those men shining like lightning in that empty room? Who was that on high when old Stephen cried, I see Jesus at the Father's right side. If God isn't real, tell me who's this I feel now moving in me.
Is he moving in you this morning? Somebody say amen. Now this whole world with its doubt, but I'm still gonna shout about what my Lord's done for me. my invisible chains. They had me almost insane, but then a God's lovely son, he set me free. The devil said it'll never last. Others tried in the past, and like them, you will drown in sin sea. But Satan, my God, sits higher than one that's a liar. And I know that you will also believe.
And that one's in
God, tell me who's that a-coming out of that tomb. And who are those men shining like lightning in that empty room? Who was that on high when old Stephen cried? I see Jesus at the Father's right side. If God isn't real, tell me who's this I feel now.
Same mighty hand that calls
seem to stand, it still gives victory. So let the flood waters roll, let the storm winds blow, let everything hell has tearing my soul. It may hinder me, bring me down on my knees, but that's as far as I'll go. Not a battle's been lost on that old rugged cross. I'm going to reach heaven no matter the cost. The next mountain I climb, I just might find sweet heavens in view. Let the flood waters roll, let the storm winds blow, let everything hell has tearing my soul. It may hinder me, bring me down on my knees, but that's as far as I'll go. Not a battle's been lost on that old rugged cross. I'm going to reach heaven no matter the cost. The next mountain I climb, I just might find sweet heavens in view. The next mountain I climb, I just might find sweet heavens in view, heavens in view.
How many of you are thankful that one of these days we're going to a land, we're going to a place called heaven? Amen, that place called heaven. There's going to be no more sickness. There's going to be no more crying over there. There's going to be no more death over there. That thing that you're struggling with this morning, that thing that you just think you can't overcome, let me tell you something, honey. If you'll hold on to God's right hand. Hey, I had a preacher told me not too long ago, you shouldn't get happy, you shouldn't get excited. He said, I hate a hacking preacher. Well, let me tell you, every day that I get up, I have to thank God for everything that he's given me. I'm so thankful that on July 7th, 2011, in bunkhouse 6, I knelt down at an altar, amen, and I asked him into my heart, and ever since I got a taste of that living water, I ain't never been the same, brother. That's what Jesus will do for you. A few years later, the Lord called me to preach. And can I tell you, I've been ridiculed since. I've had people tell me I can't do it. I've almost thrown in the towel so many times. But can I tell you, if it wasn't for that place called heaven that was promised for me, there ain't no telling where I'd be right now. I might be on drugs. There's a lot of people my age, 23 years old, that are out in the world doing stuff they have no business doing. They were raised in church. Some of them might have been raised right here in this church. We never know nowadays. That's why we need to stay prayed up. We need to stay fasted up. There's a lot of people nowadays that just don't get the power of the Holy Ghost. We're losing a generation because we're not operating in the power and the unction of the Holy Ghost of God. This morning, whatever you're dealing with, we're not even halfway through the service yet. But I felt the Lord tell me to tell somebody that if you need this altar, there's healing in the house this morning. There's healing for you. Amen. I tell you what, I needed this morning because I haven't felt the power of the Lord. Hey, I've been on the road hot and heavy for 6 years now. And I love the presence of the Lord. I love when the Lord comes down and he sweeps by. Don't let him pass by without jumping in. I promise you. Come on in. The water's just fine.
Let the flood waters roll. And let the storm winds blow. And let everything that hell has tearing my soul. You see, it may hinder me and bring me right down here on my knees. But let me tell you, Satan, that's as far, that's as far, that's as far as I'll go. It's not a battle's been lost on that old rugged cross. I'm going to reach heaven no matter the cost. The next mountain I climb, I just might find sweet heavens in view. Let the flood waters roll, let the storm winds blow, let everything hell has tearing my soul. It may hinder me, bring me down on my knees, but that's as far as I'll go. On that old rugged cross, I'm going to reach heaven no matter the cost. The next mountain I climb, I just might find sweet heavens in view. Amen. Thank you, Lord. just getting sweeter all the time, man. I tell you, I'm looking forward one day to getting over there and seeing my little grandmother over there. Looking forward to seeing my dad over there, amen. Lord, I bet Dad is happy as all get out, amen. Lord, if there's a banana pudding in heaven, I'm sure he's found it, amen. I tell you what, though, home is getting sweeter. And you know, church, the way the world looks now, it's getting closer and closer to our Lord coming back, amen. And I tell you what, a lot of us are going to be surprised when he does by who goes and who don't sometimes, amen. But I want to encourage you this morning, if you have any kind of doubt, that you make it right before you leave here today, amen. Because I tell you what, I want to see all of y'all in heaven. You know, that's like that old song says, I want us to be together in heaven. Amen, that song right there. I tell you what, there's truth in that song. I want us all to be there, serving and praising our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I love this song. And if you know it, you sing it with us. It says, my home.
It's a long and dusty road and my feet, they are traveling on, and sometimes, oh, the clouds are dark and low. Oh,
Dad loved coming up here. He said, I was not going because Patty always takes real good care of me up there. She makes sure I got what I need. I said, she does? She goes, yeah. She said, I try to stay on Patty's good side. I said, are you scared of Patty? She goes, have you met Patty? You stay on her good side. I tell you, we love her. But, you know, Dad loved that song right there. There were times, Dad, we'd be just riding in a road, or somebody'd ask my dad to sing a song for me. That's what he'd always sing for me. You know, I think about it from time to time, riding home from work, or just when I got some alone time by myself. You know, if you've lost someone, you really loved them, that pain don't ever go away. Don't really ever go away. You may can deal with it and smile now, but, you know, a little thing can happen. Lord, it's been as bad sometimes as I ran through and I could hear Daddy, Lord, Eric, I sure could use a Crystal Burger right now. I said, a Crystal Burger? He couldn't stand it. We'd head up his way. He goes, Lord, all they got is White Castle up here, Eric. He said, well, there need to be a Crystal somewhere around here. I said, Daddy, they're pretty much the same thing. He said, don't you ever say that again. But I tell you what, heaven is going to be sweet over there. Amen. I know Dad, he's not in any pain, not struggling anymore. Lord, he's probably buzzing all around that place like he always said he would. And I tell you, I'm so thankful for a Christian home, a Christian family. And a mom and dad who wasn't scared to tell me about the Lord. And wasn't scared to whoop me every now and then too, amen. Because sometimes I think, hey, you need that every so often, don't you? I sure did hate it at the time. But I'm glad they done it. Because I tell you what, it was done out of love is what it was done. And, you know, I want to sing a little bit of that song again. I'm just going to sing it. And if y'all would, sing it with me. For my home is just around the bend. I think about it now and then. Reunions by the millions everywhere. But the one that I so long to see is the one who bled and died for me. My home, my home, a place I long to be. For my home is just around. That's my home. I want to ask my mother to come up. Hey, man, you want to hear my mom sing a song for you this morning? Mom here, she does a wonderful job, and she sung this song forever with Dad. And I tell you what, Mom, I just wanted you to say a word for the Lord, share your heart this morning.
Oh, I just wanted to say good morning, everybody, and thank y'all for coming. This is one of our special churches we always look forward to because you always make us feel at home. You can feel love in this church when you walk in the door, and I appreciate all of y'all. Y'all pray for us on the road.
Since the Lord came into my soul, heaven has been my goal, and I prayed within my heart I'd make it through. But Lord, you know my weakness, so help me to be strong. If you see center of thy perfect will, take me home, dear Lord, if you should see that I'm about to fail, for I don't want to miss that mansion that I've been waiting for so long. So if you see that I might fail, Lord, take me step nearer to that city John saw coming down. I'm almost home, so Lord, don't let me fail. Take me home or keep me in the center of thy perfect will. Take me home, dear Lord, if you should see that I fail, for I don't want to miss that mansion that I've been waiting for so long. So if you see that I might fail, Lord, take me home. So if you see that I might fail, Lord, take me
tell you what, I'm so thankful. Linda's been like a mom to me on the road. I remember when I first joined back in 2017, that was the woman that I was scared of because she's the one that wrote the paycheck. Amen. And I was blessed to be able to be on the road full time. But I work a full time job now, but I was blessed to be on the road 3 years full time with this group. And I don't regret a mile. Us boys have seen a lot of things, and we've learned from the best today. And we sure miss Ernie. And he was like a father to me, and I remember when my parents were going through a divorce, and these people are all I had. These up here are my brothers. You don't have to be blood to be brothers, and I love these guys up here this morning. If you have any doubt in your mind, I love them just like brothers this morning, and I can assure you that we fight just like brothers too, and maybe one day you'll get to see it. But how many of y'all know that prayer can change things? If you'll just have the faith the size of a grain of mustard seed, you can move mountains. That's what the word says today. And this song talks about prayer, and it's called The Old Weapons. They still work. Prayer still works, folks. Listen to this song. This world is so wicked, troubles on every hand. Now these burdens, they get so heavy, I cry, dear Lord, just help me stand. Now when the enemy rages, I pray till I know that Jesus heard. And in the heat of the battle, I've learned the old weapons still work. Listen to this.
But now peace only comes when someone has counted the cost and is willing to lay down his life for the sake of the cause. Oh, you see, it was Jesus, my sacrifice, there on an old rugged tree. As he hung there dying, he won every battle for me. Oh, yes, face him whose mountains that stand in our way, and prayer is the door to heaven someday. We still need Jesus for the battle we face, my friend. No matter what you have heard, the old weapon still wears. Faith still moves mountains that stand in our way, and prayer is the door to heaven someday. We still need Jesus for the battle we face, my friend. No matter what you have heard, the old weapon still works. My friend, no matter what you have heard, your weapon still works. Weapon still.
Tell you what, prayer changes things, amen. You know, I want to sing you a song. There's a guy that works with me, and this friend of mine, he's went through a lot, amen. And you know, I was talking to him the other day. He said, Lord, I've had thing after thing after thing happen to me. He said, Lord, I've came home from work and worked 40 hours. He said, was trying to get a little bit of overtime, make sure a little side money going in, doing some work for a friend. He said, I came home, and my wife had totally left me. Took everything out of the house, everything was gone. And he looked at me, he said, you know, at first I was mad, and I was bitter. He said, but then I realized, you know, I was living for me. I wasn't living for the Lord. He said, I was putting more praise in a paycheck and going and party than was going to church, trying to lead a good life. He said, the Lord had to bring me to my knees to make me stand on my feet. Amen. And I tell you what, I want to sing a song for you that goes out to any of you who's came down and changed your life. You know, I see a lot of people say, Eric, man, you wouldn't like the man I used to be. Amen. You wouldn't like that guy. That guy was a totally different person. I said, well, I don't know the person you was. I know the person you are. Amen. And it's crazy. God can take something dirty and nasty and shine it up and make it clean and pure. Amen. Amen. I want to tell you this morning that you don't have to walk out of here the same way you walked in. Amen. You don't have to. All you got to do is ask him into your heart. And I tell you what, it'll be the biggest high you ever got in your life. Amen. There's no drugs that can touch Jesus. Amen. And I tell you, I want to sing this song for any of you that says, I'm not the man I used to be. Just where the Lord has brought me. since I first found God's grace. You see, friend, I've stumbled and I've fallen many times along life's way. But I can think back. I can think back to a place in time when Jesus, He set me free. And I know that I'm not that man that I used to be. And when I stand singing one more song. We're going to have the pastor come up and preach here. But I want to tell you, I'm thankful that I'm not that man I used to be. Amen. I tell you what, there's a lot of things that, Lord, I'm not proud of. But I tell you what, I'm so proud of the day that I went down and I asked God to come into my heart and save my soul. And you know what? All those things in my past, He's totally forgot. Amen. He's washed me clean. Amen. And I tell you what, I can't wait one day when I walk up, He says, enter in, my good and faithful servant, into the glories of heaven. Amen. I tell you what, heaven's going to be a wonderful place. But I'm going to tell you, church, there's going to be a lot of people that tries to tell you that. I remember Dad always said, we are not the minority. Amen. Christians, we are the majority. Amen. And with us, we together, we can do anything. And I want to tell you, Buddha is dead. Muhammad is dead. There's one named Jesus Christ. How many believe that He is alive? Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Once I went walking down a long, lonely road. I thought I had no one who would share my heavy load. But then my mind went soaring back to a place I had never been. Then I realized that I was standing at the foot of my King. There were three lonely crosses on a hillside that day. And as I looked at my Savior, I cried, Lord, take. Blood flowing down and thorns pierced His that you see hanging there, well, Jesus, he's not dead. He's alive. He's alive. No.
I was walking around the field the other day, and the little dog was in front of me. We were walking, and I thought, I used to run once in a while when the Lord was moving, and I felt good. And I used to run. I don't like to dance. Thank you, brother. Didn't come on. So I decided I was going to run. I'm 86 years old now, just turned another day or two. And I found in my life, down through the years, that God will help us, and I think it'll make me feel better. You know what I'm going to do? Over here. Brother Denton, you can't beat that.
Can I do that?
No. Yeah, he's gonna try.
No, I thought you were asking me, can I do that? No, I'd probably run into a pew. You want me to do that? I can't dance. I tried. I don't know if I can run or not. You mean run? I'll run.
long way.
Can you hear me? Let's do one other thing, and I'm going to turn it over to... Let's take the time and get up and worship God for a few minutes. He's the reason we're here. He's the cause of us being here. He said he would make us, I guess, what we need to be. I've had COVID, and I lose a little bit of track. My memory's not as good as it used to be, and you have to put up with me a little bit losing track, because I don't lose track of God, never have, never will. I know where God is, I know where I'm going, I'm heaven-bound, and whether the devil likes it or not, I don't care. The devil is a liar. He decided that he was going to kind of bear down on me hard, so he's given me a run for the money, so to speak. I'm glad, though, that I have been given the privilege. 56 years I've pastored this church.
Hallelujah.
And I can't think of a thing I'd rather do than have the same thank you going back again. If I could go back 50 years, you better believe I'd still be doing the same old thing. Because I found a promise, and I found a home, amen, that I know where I'm going. And I don't have to worry about what the devil's up to. I'm not too concerned with him. Amen. Come on. Let's get Brother Denton on the... Are you going to say something?
He's going to take the test.
Brother Jimmy reminded me. Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
Let's give God a big hand clap of praise this morning. Hallelujah. And now one of my favorite groups, Heirline. Did they do a great job today or what? Yeah. Amen. Let's give them a hand clap. Yes. Thank you. Amen.
I think we've had a wonderful, wonderful singing. And next Sunday, we're about to have them back again. And then the next Sunday, we're about to do that.
Amen.
I feel good.
Amen.
I may not be as surprised as I used to be, but I'm just as lucky.
86 years old, I think he's doing really good. Really good. Brother Denton, that was impressive, you guys.
Don't give him no ideas, nobody.
Oh, would the ushers come up? We're taking up our Sunday offering. The young men that are here, yeah. What a beautiful service so far. Amen?
I can still run.
You can still run. And like they said in their singing tonight, church, all of our hope is in Jesus Christ. Run to him for all of our answers. He's the way, the truth, and the life. Never go wrong running to that name of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Amen. Brother Andy, you want to ask a blessing? Amen. Would y'all give this young man, Brother Denton, a hand clap here, and he's going to bring the word for us this morning. God bless Brother Denton.
Listen, because you're going to hear some good preaching and talking about something that I have longed for a lot of years now. That's going on.
Bless you, Pastor. I love you.
Yeah, I love you too. You know, we're getting old. He's kind of getting up there with me too.
Yeah, I've been following you. You're just a few years ahead of me. Well, praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
I'd like to say it's a great honor to be here today. It's a great honor to be in church. It's a very wonderful thing for you to allow me to try and preach to you and say something to you today. I thank the Heirlines for the music and the word and singing. Appreciate them. I appreciate all of you that I've known down through the years. Some of you as a child and others in work, but in the best relationship in church. And there's just something about church. And then when you get an opportunity to be in front of somebody like this group, you'd be almost impossible to say all the right things. So you pray for me and forgive me if I don't say the right things or it doesn't sound right to you. I really don't know the right things to say, except I know that God does. And so I tried to spend some time to find the right scripture or thought line. Every service has a theme, and homecomings are so special, very special services. And we know that every one of us has a soul that will not die, that the death of a soul means that it's lost out with God, but it will live on through either heaven or hell. And so we have an opportunity in life, but we have a commitment in life. And we're charged with the fact that we should take this soul and we should make sure that it goes to be with God for eternity and not with the devil in hell. This is our responsibility. It's our privilege. We are honored, each one of us, with the ability to be able to perform what we should to be able to go to heaven. God never asked for you and I to be in competition. I cannot be you and you cannot be me, but you have exactly what it takes for you to make it, but it will take everything that you have. You will not make it being lackadaisical. You will not make it being a critic. You will not make it without giving it all that you have. I can say that. You can, you know that you can say, okay, preacher, it doesn't matter what you say. In one sense, that's true. But on the other hand, where are you at today with your salvation walk? Where are you at? I remember there was a time in the Bible when the kings got together and they were going to go out to battle. And as they were getting ready to go out, the prophets had all told them, go on, you're going to win. Go on out there, you're going to win. And they said, well, we got this one other feller, this other feller. Let's ask him what he says. And he said, yeah, just go on, go on. And they said, no, that's not what we want. We don't want you to tell us to just go on like, we want you to tell us what God says. All right. Right. He said, all right, that's different then. See, he said, you want to know what God's got in stand? You want to know what his plans are? He said, you ain't going to win out there. Right. You're not going to. I'm going to tell you that, what do you want today? Would you like for me to be able to say some good words and read a couple of good scriptures and tell you that heaven's the only thing in the Bible, there is no hell? Would you like that? Or would you like for me to tell you something that you can think about? Huh? I don't never tell people they have to do this or do that. In the church that I pastor, I don't make people do anything. I don't make them. Nobody can make you do anything. But I suggest to them from the scripture what they need to do. And I'd like to suggest today something to you. I'd like to go back in your memory a little bit, and I'd like to talk to you about a time perhaps when you were at your most sincere moment in life and that you made a commitment to God. You committed yourself to a way of serving God. Church. Churchy. We're churchy people. We're church. That's what we are. We are the church. We cannot go back and change yesterday, but you can take care of tomorrow if you want to. As you leave here today, you can leave a changed person, and let's you're convinced that you don't need any changing. Now, if you're serving God to the very best of your ability, you ain't lying, you ain't cheating, you ain't stealing. Come on, you ain't doing none of those things. You're not committing adultery. You're not doing nothing wrong. You know, if you're not doing anything wrong, but if you are, then let's think about it. The Bible would go so far as to say, if you know to do good and don't do it, it's a sin. Sin not to do good because you know it to do it and don't do it. That's how close God would put it. I know for a fact the Bible would say that hell has enlarged itself, but it doesn't say anything about heaven needing to do that. Okay. All right, I hear you. In the book of Numbers. Some of you would like me to get on and get with it here. In the book of Numbers, the 30th chapter, for one verse, the second verse. In the book of Numbers, 30th chapter, the second verse. We will also be going to Ecclesiastes. I never say that right, but that's where we're going. In the 30th chapter and the second verse, if a man vow a vow unto the Lord, or swear an oath to bind his soul with a bond, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceedeth out of his mouth. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. If a man vow a vow. Now, tried to pastor a church for a few years, and I performed some weddings and things. And when people come up, I use the old-time vows. I've had women that tell me they won't take those vows. I said, you need to find some other preacher to marry you. I use the old-time original vow. When somebody comes up to get married and they stand before the preacher and they're in front of the congregation, they bring heaven and earth to record that they make a vow unto that marriage and unto God. But they don't always consider it a very strong necessity. So a lot of times they lose that. Okay? Now I'm not worried about your marriage myself. I'm not. I'm just saying that you make a vow. How many in here had any military background? Anybody in any military background? I see some. You stood in a room with about 30 other people, and you raised your right hand, and you took an oath to serve the United States Army, Marines, Navy, or wherever you was at, and you took an oath to obey them, and you made an agreement with them. Amen? Now, that agreement, you better stick with it, because in the Army, if you don't, you'll find yourself down at Fort Leavenworth. Right, brother? Leavenworth, that's a bad place if you don't know, but Leavenworth's a bad place. So that's where you're going to find yourself if you don't keep that oath. All right. Now, if you marry a woman and you don't keep that oath, you'll probably be doing your own dishes, making your own bed, washing your own clothes, and eating lonely.
Right. Amen.
Probably. I mean, it's a good chance, right?
Yeah, definitely.
That's one oath. Now, when you want your car, you went down to the finance company and you put your John Henry and you took this contract, which is a commitment, which is an oath, and you said, I'll give you this many payments for the title to give back to that car. And they said, okay, no problem. And then you get a little lax and you get a little behind, and the next thing you know, there's somebody out in your front yard driving your car off. If you break that oath. But you made an oath to God one day. You made an oath to God. Don't tell me you didn't. And you told God that you would serve him. And some of you are not keeping that oath. You're not obeying that oath. So what you're going to do is, even though you know the truth, even though you know the gospel, even though you know the Bible, even though you felt God, even though you've been with God, you're going to lose out and wind up being in a place called hell. Now, I know that ain't the popular kind of preaching, and this don't give you any popularity with it, but I wouldn't do anything to hurt you or nobody. I have no desire. I don't even have an enemy. I refuse to have enemies. If I've got an enemy, I forgive him. He's no longer an enemy. I will not have an enemy. I can't afford them. You make an oath. If you are going to keep that oath, you're going to have to straighten up, live right, do right. Amen. Come on. You're going to have to get in church. You're going to get in church right. It's not only required to do the right thing, but you're required to do it with the right attitude. Right? How many children have obeyed what the parent told them, but they did it in such a fashion that they got a couple smacks before they got out of reach? Your attitude, it said. That's what I hit you for. Got your attitude. You were going, but you weren't going with the right attitude.
Amen.
I guess it goes a long ways. We learn a lot from animals. And you can treat a dog like a dog. You can treat them bad. And it ain't very long the dog will come back to you and won't hold a grudge. Some dogs do, but most of them are very forgivable. People are pretty bad to hold a grudge. They say, preacher, the reason I don't go to church is in 1934, I was in a service and there was a preacher treated me bad and I said I'd never go back. So you made that oath and you're living up to that oath,
But boy, you ain't living up to the one you made to God. What said, if a man vow a vow unto the Lord or swear an oath to bind his soul with a bond, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceedeth out of his mouth. What a man says, come on, when a man or woman makes a commitment to God, you need to live up to that commitment. Don't worry about tomorrow. Don't worry about Monday. It's not in your hands. Monday's not your concern. Today is your concern. This day, this hour. Not tomorrow. Tomorrow, it may or it may not be yours. It'll depend on God. But whether it is or whether it not, you got today. Now, there's some of you here, and I have been to my house, and you've shared my biscuits and gravy, and you put your feet under my table, and I love you for it, and you're welcome back. And any of you here that want to come and see if we got a biscuit, that's fine, too. You can do that. I'll be glad to have you. Not all at one time. But I'm saying this. This is not what's important. What's important is, what are you going to do about your soul? Listen, some of us may not be here next year. We may not make another year. We may not see another homecoming. We may not see next Sunday. We may not see tomorrow. We don't know. But I'm not trying to scare you. I'm just telling you what the facts that is this. If you don't change somewhere along the way and keep that vow that you made with God, you made a vow. Why are you not keeping that vow? Why? Are you blaming somebody else for your not keeping that vow? You got some excuse somewhere for not keeping it? Come on, why are you not keeping the vow that you made to God? Is the world keeping you from it? Your busy life, your social circle. What is it that keeps you from serving God? Sometimes people are worried about what their family will say. Some people are worried about what their family will say. Some people are worried about what the neighbors say. I can't imagine anything any worse than the words, "Depart from me, I never knew you." But we prophesied in your name. We did a lot of things in your name. Depart from me. What did he say? Depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. You still working iniquity? You're not working for God. You can't do both. You can't be Mary Jane's husband and Sally Sue's husband and Susie's husband. You can't do that. It don't work. You got to make an oath and stick with it. And you got to make a commitment and stick with it. Amen. You can't commit your soul to God at an altar somewhere in your life and say, God, I'll serve you. And now you're out serving the devil. You're out serving the world. You're doing what the world does. Come on. Why are you cold? Why are you cold to church? You think it's because of preachers like me, or is it because of the lighting's too bright? Or what excuse are you putting in your figuring to say why you are cold with God? Why would a man die? Why would he go to hell? Why would he go down into the pit? Why would he do that? Answer that to yourself. Answer it and say why. You can't patch up a life of sin. You can't patch it up. The Bible teaches entirely against that. You got to have a new life. It's got to be all new. When the sparkle of the world comes, you don't need that sparkle of the world. You don't need the latest fashion. You don't need the latest thing that everybody in the world has. You don't need it. I'm not trying to hurt you or put you down. I'm saying that you need to stick to an oath that you know it's right with God. Why are we in a situation in the world where mothers won't be mothers to their children? they'd rather be addicted to a syringe and hook up. Why do we have that all of this kids that they're sitting at home or sometimes parked in a car in a back alley while mom and dad's in a bar drinking? Why do we live in a society like that? Why do these people think that that's okay? If you're so dumb, you don't know where kids come from, you need to find out, because if you had some, you know. And if you've got any kids, you owe them. Amen. You owe them. I don't care what you say, you still owe them. Amen. Right. You don't owe your rock and roll fame. You don't owe that. You owe yourself. Why do you think men and women have worked their fingers to the bone over the years and made a nation that was a supreme nation in all the world, that we led the world? We are bread bowl for everybody. We're able to feed the world. We're able to protect the world. Why? Where did them people come from? They came from households where mom and dad went to church, where they worked night and day, where they put their efforts into the family and not into some rock star. I was kind of astonished a day or two ago. Somebody was talking about the greatest country star ever was. And so I looked. I wanted to see who is the greatest country star. I never heard of him. I don't remember the name now, but I never heard of him. And I guess they're the greatest country star there's ever been. Well, congratulations. I'm just a child of God. I'd rather sing about on a hill far away. Stood an old rugged cross. There's not many people worried about that cross today. But I'll tell you, I'm glad that somebody was able to go up there and walk across the Brook Kidron, walk up on the other side, go past them old ancient olive trees, and walk up there and go to Golgotha and die for a no good nothing like me. I'm glad for that. I'm glad there was a cross on an old rugged hill. I'd rather focus my eyes on that than I would on the things of the world. I don't need the things of the world. Let me tell you this. There's ice that is hard, and then there's the hardest ice. The hardest ice is ice that melts and refreezes, melts and refreezes, melts and refreezes. That's the hardest ice. It becomes harder. For some reason, it's harder than just frozen ice. When people come to church, they hear the singing, their hearts melt. Maybe the word, maybe the preacher say something, and their heart think about it. Maybe I could get some of you or one of you to think about what you said to God. An oath that you took some long time ago, or even if it was yesterday, an oath that you said, God, I will do what's right. I will live right. I will go right. I will give my efforts to be a Christian more than I will to be successful in any other walk of life. If you made that commitment and you're not doing that, think about it. Think about it. This is what you need to concentrate on, because you come to church, you feel good. I know people that come to church, they feel good. They get down to the altar, they cry, and they weep, and it's good. And they get up, and they walk back out the door and go right back out there, and their heart is harder now than it was before when they come in. Every time they do that, their heart gets harder. It used to be that when you preach, people would get up crying and weeping and run to the altars. And today, if you can touch a soul at all, you're doing good. I went to a church where I preached for many years, and they were down in Kentucky in the hills, and I went down there and I preached, and I said, let's come and pray. And they sat there. They sat there. And I said, I want to tell you something. I ain't never been in a church that I asked people to pray that nobody come. And one by one, they came up and they began to pray, and God moved What I'm saying is, you need to not be melted when you come to church or read the word or hear a Christian song and feel good and then go right back out to the hard-hearted way. I hate that guy over there because he did me wrong. I don't ever speak to this family member because they've done this to me. I won't do this and I do that. I had a man told me that he had the Holy Ghost. Now, I know he'd been baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for remission of sins. And I heard him, I guess, speak in tongues. And he was working. He hung drywall. And he said, I need a quart of beer and 10 cents, was 10 bucks, I think. 10 cents of something, Coke maybe. He said, I'd take that dime's worth and that quart of beer. He said, I drank that, and he said, I sleep good. I said, man, if I had drugs in my house, I couldn't go to sleep. I wouldn't sleep until I got them out and destroyed them. I couldn't have them, let alone take them and say I'm a Christian. Yeah, the only stimulant I need, I get in from God. I don't need some kind of a whiskey or wine. Was preaching in Pennsylvania. Children were farmed out. In those days, we farmed them out. We'd come to the church, and then two of these children would go home with these, and two of them would go over there. We didn't have money for motels, so they slept wherever they could find a bed, and somebody would take them in and feed them and sleep them while you're there. One of the kids come back and said, Dad, said, do you know they drink wine? No, I didn't know they drank wine. I said, yeah, they drank wine with their meal every night. They drink wine before they go to bed. Huh? Shame on them. Is that what you said? Thank you. Shame on them. Amen. Come on. I've been in church a long time. I don't know how long. But I've been in church a long time. And I ain't had any alcohol since I've been in church. And if God help me, I won't have none until I die. Come on. You can have your coolers, or you can have what you want. I know a pastor down by Logansport, and he's got a little mini refrigerator beside his bed, and he keeps his wine coolers and stuff in there because he drinks them at night until he feels rosy and goes to sleep. Woo! Ha! It ain't what I call church. You know, I intend to make heaven my home for an eternity. And any effort that it takes on my part here, anything that I've got to say no to. Listen, some of you are young enough to be my children, grandchildren, maybe great-grandchildren. But some of you, I know, I've seen you shed your tears in the altar. I've seen you cry. Listen, let's go back to that oath. Let's go back to that commitment that we made to God. Let's get down where it ought to be with it, and let's make sure that we secure our soul. You could die unsaved if you don't get right with God and make it up. Ecclesiastes in the 5th chapter, the 4th verse, EC 5 and 4. Just a kind of a reiteration. When thou vowest a vow unto God, defer not to pay it, for he hath no pleasure in fools. Pay that which thou hast vowed. That's God saying. I know people that sometimes they'll drive to another city because there's a good place there to eat. They got a good restaurant. Sometimes they'll go on the other side of town, or they'll go to the highest price because they got good food there. They want good food. You know, I'm not knocking that. I do that myself too. I'm not knocking that. I'm saying that we go to long ends. We go to a deep search. We get on our phones and we find out where the best restaurant's at, and we ask people, Where do you get the best seafood? Where do you do this? Where do you do that? And we make a great effort to get what we want to put in this body, in this fleshly body. Now, I want this body. I take my medicine. I go to the doctor. I let him pat me on the back and listen to my chest and see if I'm breathing and stuff like that. I go and I do that because I'm going to live as long as I feel it's all right with God. So I eat pretty good, and I got pretty good vitals. When you check my records and look at things, I'm in pretty good standing with everything. So why would people who go to great extremes, to great efforts to find good food, clean food for their body, turn around and eat dirty slop for their soul? Now, I've never went to Burger King and said, it's all right if I go back in the back alley and get into your dumpster. I never have. I ain't saying I won't. I might have to sometime, but if I do, then I'll do it. But I'm saying this. As long as I can get it across the counter up front, I'm not going to eat the slop and the trash. People will eat Hollywood religion. If you think that there's one TV program or one Hollywood program that will help you with your walk with God, you, friend, you need to get educated. Amen. Come on. You need some grouchy old man to tell you that you are out of your mind. You're eating slop for your soul when you make a big effort to eat good things for your body. Why don't you make the same effort and go into the book of King James Version? Why don't you go in the old Bible? We don't need a new Bible. We just need to obey the old Bible. One Lord. Ephesians 4 and 5. One Lord. One faith. How many faith? How many according to the Bible? How many lords? One Lord. One faith. How many baptisms? One baptism. One baptism. They never baptized in the Bible. They never baptized other than in the name of Jesus, Jesus Christ, and Lord Jesus. They never did. Nobody in the Bible ever repeated 28 and 19 Matthew, because that is fulfilled in Acts 2:38. Everybody knows Father, Son, the Holy Ghost is not a name. You be quiet. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, that's not a name. And a lot of people tell you they were baptized in His name. There are a lot of churches that will tell you this: I'll baptize you any way you want to get baptized. Why don't you go back to Ephesians 4 and 5 and say there's one Lord, one faith, and one baptism, and go to Acts 2:38 and know that that's the only baptism there is in the Bible. Now, I'm suggesting you look at it. All right. I'm suggesting you consider it and think about it. Go to the 19th chapter of Acts and consider what they say there. Consider what when the disciples, I'm not talking about rank sinners, disciples, followers of Christ, when they themselves did not know until Paul told them about the baptism. Think about it. I'll be done just a little bit. I don't have a lot more to say. A backslider is never at home. He doesn't fit in with the world. He doesn't fit in with the church. He has no home. There's a book, I think, called A Man Without a Country. He has no country. He has no home. He doesn't fit in. Once you've known God, once you've had the Holy Ghost, you can go back out there and drink, you can cuss, you can play poker, you can do anything you want to do, but you ain't never happy. Never, never happy. As a matter of fact, once any person ever walks in an apostolic church and hears an apostolic message preached, they are never, never the same. You can't back up. You can't say you didn't hear it. It's something that will be with you for the rest of your life. The question is, what are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about your vow? What are you going to do about your oath? What are you going to do about what you told God? I'm not talking about your marriage. I ain't talking about your commitment on your car. I ain't talking about what you told the United States Army. But I'm talking about, what did you tell God? What did you say to him? What did you say when your heart was broke and your life was tore up and you come down to an altar and God met you and you felt an old nail-scarred hand come around you while you prayed? What did you say to him? Are you obeying that? Because as the songs were, if you are obeying to the very best of your ability the oath that you made with God, you know and I know that if you've come down, repented, and you've been baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for remission of sin, you shall receive the Holy Ghost. Now, you know this is a plan. Amen. You know that. Are you defending that plan? Are you upholding it? Are you preaching it? Are you making it the pinnacle of all success for everybody? Is this what they need? Is this what they need to teach in school? I'm going to tell you how powerful these things are. They don't let you teach anything about religion in school usually, right? So we had a granddaughter going to school, and for some reason or another, some kind of little program, they had a church bring in and they presented something and they had them doing that. And she said, well, if they can do that, why can't I have a little group? And they said, well, you can if you want to then. So then she got a little group and she took King James Version Bible and she told them all about salvation. And she done it in school because God was with it. God is in it. Now, you know that in a normal sequence, they're not going to let you teach religion in school. But they did. They did. Amen. Richard Snow was in prison down at Grissom Hill down there. He was in prison, and he got a chance to come to Marion, Indiana, to appear before a judge to see if the judge would recommend him, just see if he would recommend him so he could go before a parole board to see maybe he could come home. Now, Richard had some time left. I don't know how much. But Richard come to court. And we in the church, we were praying. And the judge, he held off Richard's case for the last one. Everybody else left. The judge looked at us and he said, well, he said, I was going to make a kind of a comical remark. He said, but I can't with you people praying like you're praying. Well, we weren't praying out loud. I guess he knew we were praying. He said, Richard, come up here. He walked up in front of the judge, and these are the people that's got the powers, right, in this world. He said, you go home with these people. He said, you can go back and get your belongings later. You know, going before no parole board, you don't have to do nothing. You're free to go. He walked out of there, went home. Because he had a daughter that laid on the altar in the church and weep and prayed and cried to God. And she said, I want my daddy. I want my daddy. I want my daddy. I've heard her say it over and over. And her daddy walked out of that courtroom and walked home too. Because don't tell me this don't work. This is it. This is all that you need is right here. You don't have to do anything if you don't want to. I'm just going to look real quick at James 2 and 20. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? If you drop down to the 26th verse, for as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. Whatever you do, don't be dead in Christ. Will you stand? I don't get things put together right a lot of times. Later on, I look back and I say, well, should have said this, should have said that.
So you forgive me if I don't say it right, but what do you say? What do you say? How are you doing right now in your thought process with God? How are you doing? Are you okay with the way you're living? Are you keeping the oath that you give to God? Are you? Would you let us? Was there anyone that would step out and let us pray with you today? Would you come down and recommit yourself? Is there anyone? Is there one brave soul that would step out and commit yourself this morning? Will you come? Is there one? Is there one? Mom, where's your kids at today? Where's your children at? Daddy, where's your boys? Where's your boys at today? Where are they at? Where are they going to be for eternity? Come on, let's help one another. We're all family. We all love one another. We need each other. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Step out. Come on. Thank you, sister. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Thank you. Come on. Step out with these. Step out with them. Step right out. Come on. Let's come down with them. Let's everybody. Let's pray a little while. Come on.
Come on. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Come on. Come on. Don't hold back. Don't hold back. Come on. Will you come? Say, will you come? Will you come? Will you come? Brother, will you come? Bring that family and come on, will you? Bring that family. Bring your family and come on down. Come on, Indian.